Testing, yes, it is on. Very much so. Well, we've got this summer day in February. Really quite extraordinary. I don't know whether I was in San Diego or in Cambridge when I was. But I think it's appropriate to be a sunny day to talk about the relative darkness of Kierkegaard. But most importantly, to try to zero in on the specificity, the distinctive characteristics of Christianity. And of course, it's impossible to do that, because anytime you talk about Christianity, as we know in this class, you've got to historicize, contextualize, and pluralize, and we keep track of the variety of different views and viewpoints, the variety of different Belgian challenges, and the larger world pictures that have flown from this very, very rich and yet at the same time flawed tradition that we talk about when we talk about Christianity. I want to be very honest about this, because it's like Kierkegaard, I talk about Christianity as someone who's been deeply shaped and molded by a particular strand and strain of Christianity. We call it left-wing Protestantism, dipped within the oppression in this nation of black people and the ways in which black people try to make sense of a Palestinian Jew named Jesus meeting with traditional voices, always focusing on love. We're going to say much, much more about the centrality of love. But I think we begin with Judaism. That you cannot even think of trying to come to terms with a variety of voices in Christianity without acknowledging the ways in which Christianity flows out of Judaism, specifically prophetic Judaism. And it goes back to Hebrew scripture, the Imago Dei, the sanctity of individual, the dignity of individuality. There's a wonderful, wonderful juxtaposition in a text, again, another text you should read before you die, by Eric Allbach, called Mimesis, published in 1946. Chapter called Odysseus's Scar, and he juxtaposes the work of Homer with that of Hebrew scripture. And he says, what is it about Odysseus that from the very beginning to the end, he is the same person, same character, ups and downs, fortune and fate, but the same persons, whereas in Hebrew scripture with Imago Dei, it's very much about what this class is about, focuses on. Change, transformation, David, Joseph, Adam, Samuel, up and down, their very character changes. They're involved in time. So there's an intimate connection between individuality and temporality. And that paragogy that we talked about with Plato, that turning of the soul, not just conversion in terms of a particular experience of conversion, but the various transformations human beings make that trains them from gangsters to decent persons, that chains them from slaves to free persons, slaves psychically, spiritually, breaking that bondage and having unbelievable experiences that are new and novel. We saw this in Emerson. Emerson presupposes all of this in terms of transformation, you see. But what Auerbach is getting at is the centrality of historicity, temporality, in the transformation of individuals. And by individuals, always talking about something concrete. Concrete. Namely, you and me. So it's existential. Not just subjective in a pejorative sense. It's existential. It is your life, your love, your laugh, your dread, your death. And in looking at it in that way, and Kierkegaard's going to be a master at this, he's always going to be highly suspicious if any modes of intellectual evasion that want to turn away from the specificity of the concrete as it has to do with us as unique single individuals in time, shaped by history, trying to remake history on our way to our own unique singular extinction. When the worms get our bodies. Anti-abstraction, anti-speculation, anti-generalization. Always keeping it
on the ground. Now, what is crucial about prophetic Judaism and talking about Imago Dei and talking about temporality and talking about history and historicity is the crucial role of remembrance. Remembrance connected to forms of piety. And this is very important in terms of modern discourse, because so much of modern discourse is obsessed and fixated with autonomous subjects who make, refashion, and create themselves. Whereas prophetic Judaism, Christianity will flow right out. You are singular individuals who must acknowledge your dependence on those that came before. No self-made here. No self-creation out of nothing here. So you begin by situating and locating yourself relative to your particular concrete mama, daddy, aunt, uncle, grandparents, community, language, tradition. And only you, in the end, can answer the fundamental question of who are you really? What are you going to do with your life? What is your vocation? What is your calling? What is your mission? So Kierkegaard always wants to put up front, flowing out of his particular understanding of Christianity, grounded in prophetic Judaism, this existential gravitas. That's what we could call it. Existential gravitas, which means, of course, Kierkegaard is highly, highly preferable for this class. Because that's what we've been talking about in terms of the critique of academic moral philosophy and so forth and so on. And their obsession with impartiality, their obsession with objectivity, their obsession with abstraction. All of these defense mechanisms, especially of the academy, to downplay the existential. But most importantly for us, and here I bring my own tradition to bear here, that Kierkegaard understands catastrophe. From the very beginning, we've talked about the catastrophic consciousness. Prophetic Judaism begins with catastrophe, enslavement, persecution, subjugation, domination, indescribable levels of suffering and misery, generation after generation after generation. We've seen over and over again, that's not a problem, that's a catastrophe. Kierkegaard understands the difference between the catastrophic and the problematic. And death, dread, despair, disappointment. Our dear brother was talking about nihilism. You mentioned nihilism the other day, and we can say a word about it. But even nihilism, we don't want to view as an abstract category. It's lived nihilism. The life of meaninglessness, the life of hopelessness, the life of lovelessness. When Kierkegaard says in the conclusion of Works of Love, a powerful text of 1847, that all of this writing comes down to the love of human beings is the only thing that makes life worth living. Without that love, you never really live. Loving human beings is the only salutary consolation in time and eternity. Says the one mark of the Christian is he or she loves their neighbor, loves their fellow human being. And of course, Kierkegaard goes on to conclude quite implicitly, which means there's hardly any Christians around. Now, Nietzsche said the last Christian died on the cross, but that's not true. Because Jesus was not a Christian. He's a prophetic Jewish brother who we Christians fell in love with. Appropriate. Only two, especially Paul, who recasts the understanding of flowing out of prophetic Judaism in that way. But Kierkegaard believes every Christian who makes such an audacious claim is forever endlessly in the process of becoming a Christian, aiming toward a certain kind of individuality in light of temporality and historicity. And you can imagine the possibilities of taking time and history seriously in such a way that
that it could lead toward a radical skepticism, what we call a wholesale skepticism as opposed to a retail skepticism. Retail is a good thing. We talked about that before, the truth in skepticism, unsettling our assumptions and presuppositions. Wholescale skepticism
suspends judgment
across the board, every worldview. Kierkegaard comes right up to that and then pulls back. Thoroughgoing contradictions and incongruities that are shot through every philosophical view, including the Christian claims about the nature of reality. And hence the unbelievable stress on humility, on human inadequacy, on human fallibility. And so therefore, any religion, but especially for Kierkegaard, Christianity, is not going to be tied primarily to dogmas and doctrine. It's going to be tied to ways of life. And raise the question, what is the life lived right and well? For Kierkegaard, it is the life of love lived right and well, but always a failure. Always a failure. That's what Samuel Beckett meant when he said, try again, fail again, fail better. Try again, fail again, fail better, Samuel. He's the last Protestant Christian. This is a good way of saying he's secular. But he's religiously musical. It's a beautiful thing to be secular and religiously musical. So many secular brothers and sisters these days are flat as a pancake when it comes to religion. Like a new atheist. False and airy, get it out of the way. Things would be wonderful. Oh, sure. Mm-hmm. Just hang out with some secular atheists for about 2 days and see how wonderful things are. Their humanity creeps up on them. The pride, the arrogance, like any other set of human beings, no matter what their beliefs. But when you're religiously musical, it means that even though you cannot engage in cognitive commitment, God talk or faith talk or grace talk or whatever, that you have a deep appreciation of what religious folk are wrestling with. Because when you opt for atheism and agnosticism, you still have to deal with the same reality. Don't do that for me.
Yeah. I'm so sorry, brother. Thank you so much. Was that true the whole time? Nobody heard nothing. I'll start again. Prophetic Judaism is... No, I'm just kidding. Thanks a lot. I don't know what happened. Or the devil working on. No, I'm just kidding. What else about prophetic Judaism? Remembrance tied to reverence, especially idolatry. Thou shalt have no other God. To remember is to try to generate an integral sense of being an individual in a community, grounded in a tradition, which is another way of saying trying to preserve, trying to conserve integrity, which is predicated on remembering examples of integrity. Examples of individuals, examples of communities, examples of families, examples of mom or dad, examples of aunts or uncles or teachers or friends or what have you. And you're not in space and time that long, right? There's a death sentence of all of us in space and time. No one of us get out of space and time alive. So that remembrance and reverence, so central to prophetic Judaism, will play a crucial role as Christianity emerges out of Judaism, especially prophetic Judaism. Last but not least is resilience, that remembrance and reverence tied to a resilience. What is resilience? Well, resilience is holding on to a promise. And what did Freud say last week? Religions cannot deliver on their promises. See, every religious person ought to have a Freudian skeleton in their closet. T. T.S. Eliot put it well. I'm not used to invoking literary geniuses who are so anti-Semitic and pro-royalist and crypto-fascist, but I love Eliot anyway. Love you, Tom. Love you, love you. Thomas Stearns from St. Louis. His introduction to Pascal's Pensée. He says, every religious face ought to be shot through with a demon of doubt. That's the Freudian skeleton that ought to be in every religious person's room. Religions do not deliver on their promises. That's the modern pagan secular brother, Sigmund Freud. And then some of us religious folks say, we take a leap anyway. Some of us religious folks say, Freud, we're going to wrestle with you the way Jacob wrestled with the angel of death in the 32nd chapter of Genesis, and you merge with new energy and a wound and a new name called Israel God Wrestler. But that doesn't mean that we have a philosophical response to Freud. Just as there's no philosophical resolution of theodicy and the problem of evil and how do you reconcile a God all-powerful and all-knowing with unbelievable mountains and layers of suffering and misery in the world, past and present and future. I'm just reading about our precious brothers and sisters in Syria today. Unbelievable. We can see the same thing in the States, in Latin America. You all know the levels of suffering. And if we're honest about that suffering, and honest about the suffering inside of ourselves, then there's going to be no speculative philosophical resolution that justifies the goodness of an ultimate power. It's going to be, what is your relation to that power, and how are you going to respond to whatever call or charge you might hear from that power? And that's what Kierkegaard is about. That's why the great Ludwig Wittgenstein said what about Kierkegaard? He is by far the most profound thinker of the 19th century. This is Wittgenstein, a Jewish brother. Vienna, tied to a Catholic sensibility, but secular to the bone, but religiously musical. That's why Kafka could read Kierkegaard and says, no one understands me but him. Jewish brother, Prague. Secular to the core, would write in his journals, there is no hope for human beings, but there is some hope for God. That's Kafka. But when he reads Kierkegaard, he says, he understands me. But Kierkegaard says from Denmark, but I'm a Christian, you know. Don't overplay, don't downplay that. But Wittgenstein and Kafka come back and say, we understand your Christianity, but we see what you're wrestling with is at the center of who we are. We have different conclusions, but we appreciate the quality of how you're trying to come to terms with your own suffering and the suffering that is shot through the history of the species. So this is just a very simplistic way of saying that one has a variety of ways of appreciating various figures without necessarily reaching the same conclusions that they reach. But when it comes to remembrance, when it comes to reverence, when it comes to resilience, and that resilience can be understood in a messianic way, looking and waiting for some messianic energy or figure to come and transform a wretched world. It could be revolutionary in terms of its implications for status quos and structures and institutions in place. It could be existentially transformative in a fundamental way, in terms of changing one's own life. And we have to keep track of all of those levels. Kierkegaard talks primarily about the last level. Kierkegaard is no political revolutionary. He's not a social revolutionary. As a thinker, as a poetic thinker, he's always looking for revolutionary transformations or what he calls metamorphosis based on existence communication. Why he has an indirect form of communication. He doesn't believe and just putting forward arguments. He does not believe that arguments change people's lives in a fundamental way. They play a role, but they're not fundamental. He believes that once they acknowledge what is at stake, life and death, their whole sense of who they are, their relation to their mothers and fathers, their relations to their loved ones, their relations to those who came before centuries down the road. It could be an intellectual relation, intellectual piety. I'm in love with Shakespeare. Hamlet changed my life. I reread it every 6 months. I'm not talking about that personally, but I'm talking about an illusory person. And I hope there are some people around still reading Hamlet every 6 months. Need a little cognac after, but but you can have an intellectual companion. It could be Melville, who said exactly the same thing as Wittgenstein. I wish I could believe. I cannot believe, but I understand those who do believe are wrestling with the same thing I am. But I'm still locked in the darkness and despair. And like in the end of Moby Dick, it looks as if that despair could almost have the last word with just the raft and Ishmael. And the raft is a coffin. That's Melville. We can have an intellectual relation to Melville. Intellectual piety. Well, let's zero in on Kierkegaard. Love. For Kierkegaard, love is a divine gift. For Kierkegaard, love is a human need. For Kierkegaard, love is a task to be executed. What does it mean? It's a divine gift. Says it's a mystery. No one knows the origins of it. So whatever interpretation you have of it, you have to acknowledge its depth and its profundity. That in the end, if you're going to say something profound about what it means to be human in the existential sense of our concrete individual lives, most of us will end up saying something about the centrality of a giving and an emptying, be it we receiving it or we giving it. I think of the great Stephen Sondheim in Passion, the last great work of his in musical theater. He says, love is not a choice, it's who I am. Loving you is not a choice, it's who I am. Ontological. Question of being. How come you've been seized by something bigger than you? What does that mean? And it's more than just knowledge, it's more than just will. It's something else. What is that something else? Kierkegaard calls it passion. But it's not a liminal passion. What is a liminal passion? Everything is expressed at a particular moment, and as soon as it's over, everything goes back to the regular, like Mardi Gras. You know, just give them 3 days, everybody breaks loose, everything's flowing, and so forth. And the fourth day, everything's back to the regular. Your shopper said, hello, how you doing? I'm working the devil. Yeah, I'm working on that. Oh, love, not like that. Ooh. Not at all. Not at all. And for Kierkegaard, he says, nobody knows where it comes from, but as a Christian, he is looking at it as a Christian, quite explicitly, quite partisan in his characterization. The lens through which I look at the world, the language game that I play, the form of life that I choose, means that it was a gift planted in me, and I cannot deny its reality. I can understand my secular brothers and sisters saying, do you recognize the love? What makes you think that God planted where to come from? Well, I don't know when it's good, but I'm not a Christian, so I can't go with it. I'm not a Muslim, I can't go with it. I'm not a follower of Judaism, I can't go with it. Well, we Christians, it is implanted in us. It's presupposed as our vocation because we are called to be loving. We are called to fulfill the rich, deep tradition of prophetic Judaism, in which the fulfillment of the law is going to be manifested in loving thy God with all thy heart, mind, and soul, and loving thy neighbor as thyself. You see how much time Kierkegaard spends on that as thyself. sadomasochistic. Not loving yourself, but think you're in love. Check yourself. You got sadomasochistic consequences following therefrom. You have to have a sense of what it is to be loved. Many of us are very blessed to have families that gave us incredible love. Mamas and daddies and so on. Kierkegaard, in that family love, the approximation of being loved. Divine gift. And that divine gift is rooted in a profound need that every human being has to love and be loved. And if love is one yet many, so it's erotic. Kierkegaard is very explicit about the role of erotic love. He was a dandy for a while and spent a lot of time doing things that were probably quasi-ungodly in Copenhagen for a few years. Got his faith back together. A bit more nasty as a writer. Erotic love. Philia, friendship. He said friendship is the greatest absolute good in space and time for individuals alongside erotic love. That's Kierkegaard. That's Kierkegaard. But then agape, divine love, the vertical, not just horizon, the horizontal, but the vertical. That source that it plants in us, here it is again, good God, I'm in. That source planted in us and should be manifest in the giving and the emptying to the neighbor. What does it mean to love thy neighbor? And of course, the claim of the Palestinian Jew named Jesus is to love thy enemies. Jesus was serious about this. To love thy neighbor and to love thy enemies means to find the image of God in them that's worthy of your love and not trump or foreclose their capacity to change no matter how bad or evil they are at the moment. Because Kierkegaard fundamentally committed. Christians fundamentally committed to the possibility of fundamental transformation for each and every individual, no matter how bad they are at the moment. And no one has the power to impose constraints on how persons end up choosing to live their lives, to be better, to improve, to experience some kind of amelioration in that way. And Kierkegaard is fundamentally concerned about ensuring that that kind of spillover is acknowledged. When he begins his text with a prayer, very important to keep in mind, he begins the works of love with a prayer. And the prayer is about what? God, we must not forget you in our reflection on works of love. He said, this book is not a book on love per se in the abstract. It's about works of love. Why? Because you can't talk about love concretely unless you talk about the fruits. Fruits. And that's very difficult in our time because we live in a culture in which we tend to be too obsessed with foliage and not the fruit. What things look like, what they appear, the spectacle, the image. Love has nothing to do in any deep sense with what the image and spectacle is. About the fruits, the works, the deeds, the concrete effects and consequences felt at the deepest level, erotically, in regard to friendship, in regard to the relation of the qualitatively different deity, Christian God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to use the language of Pascal, who prefigures so much of what Kierkegaard is really about. Not the God of the philosophers, but the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The God that tells Abraham, I'm going to see how much you really love me, because love is not just a having, but it's also a relinquishing. It's also a giving up. Are you willing to give up your precious son who you waited so long was Sarah to have, and named him Laughter because it seemed to be funny that she could have a child so old in life. That's the primacy of a certain kind of love. Are you a knight of faith, or are you a knight of resignation? That's what fear and trembling was about. Abraham will see what kind of love will be manifest. Why? Because in time, it's impossible to be fundamentally committed to love and not be prepared to deal with the inescapable sorrow and hurt of losing your beloved. The death, disease, betrayal. And you are naked with no defense. Freud talked about that briefly in Civilization of Discontents last week we saw. Because that's what love does to you. It not just brings out deep and dark dimensions of who you are, but it renders you thoroughly vulnerable. You've taken the ultimate risk, and you know sooner or later it's coming. And this is true for the death of our parents, and death of our friends, or for some of us, tragically, unfortunately, sometimes even the death of your children. How equipped are you to deal with it? Can you hold on to the love in light of that kind of catastrophic shattering? So when Kierkegaard, and I want to bring this to a close, have a good time for dialogue. When he talks about divine gift, human need, then the task is going to be the life lived. The life lived. And he talks about it primarily in terms of infinite debt. You see, that to be in love is to have an infinite debt and to revel in being indebted to the person you love. You see, you can't wait to get in deeper debt. It's like the fifth year of your marriage and you buy your that card from the CVS. Pick out some wonderful words, and you say, my baby, I am so deeply in debt that I got a joy inside of me language cannot describe. You understand what I'm talking about? Kierkegaard's notion of love as infinite debt. And it's not quid pro quo. It's not exchange. It's because you recognize that you have been given something so precious and priceless that it's a matter of you at the deepest level of your passion, your sense of who you are, wanting to give as you receive. And for Kierkegaard, the central figure, the absolute paradox, the redeemer, the prototype, is God's profound love for human beings such that given the constitution of who we are, finite, infinite, free, tied to necessity, or possibility and necessity, temporal and eternal, the synthesis who we are, which is a self-relation, an acknowledgement of those elements, was manifest at its highest level in God choosing to become human in a lowly form, a king as a servant, based on Hebrew scripture, spreading hesed, loving kindness, to the least of these. To the orphan and the widow, the fatherless and the motherless, the poor, the weak, the vulnerable. That's so that the face, the temporal face of God, manifests concretely in this God who becomes human, who chooses to come from not the ruling class, but the artisanal class, carpenter, in deep solidarity with an oppressed people. Not just an oppressed people in a broad, homogenizing sense of precious Jewish brothers and sisters, but the oppressed ones within the Jewish community. Because this Palestinian Jew is willing to run out some Jewish folk in the temple if they're doing the wrong thing. It's a matter of morality and spirituality. It's not a matter of tribe and clan. It's at the deep level of spiritual integrity and moral magnanimity, moral greatness of character. So that when Kierkegaard talks about this love, he says, oh, I can see that our understanding always so glimpse-like, always so inadequate of what this God of love is like is manifest in this particular Palestinian Jew who lives a life of 33 years trying to spread this loving kindness and ends up on a cross. And it's here where Kierkegaard gets in a lot of trouble, but he doesn't mind. You see, he says because of the way of the cross and the ways of the world are so fundamentally different, they clash at the deepest level. And it's because of the sheer wretchedness of human beings in terms of their possibility of choosing bad and evil as opposed to love and having the courage to view that love as a task to execute, not just a language to talk about or go through the rituals and the ceremonies of the institutionalized religion and still being indifferent and callous toward the very folk that Jesus was highlighting. And that's one of the reasons why Kierkegaard was also so deeply, deeply demonized in his own day. And he welcomed it because he understood that anybody who has the audacity to follow the way of the cross must pick up their cross and be crucified on it with joy, because the world will come at you tooth and nail. And if the world is not coming at you tooth and nail, and they pat you on the back, you need to check yourself from a Kierkegaardian Christian point of view. But Amos would agree. Esther would too. My dear sister.
I really enjoyed
the Kierkegaard. Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Let yourself be up. No, Sister Angel, you raised a deep question there. I mean, one is that Kierkegaard understands what William James highlighted. I think I've made this point before in the class when he said the core of the religious problem is the call for help. It's the call for help. And you see it in Miss Lonely Hearts by the great Nathaniel West of 1933, and probably the greatest short story written in a comic form in the history of American literature. Only Mark Twain comes close, and he is better than Nathaniel West. And it's help. That's the first question. Help. Miss Lonely Hearts, you know, it's like an Ann Landers writer who people send letters in. Oh, I lost my nose, and I have to go through life without a nose. What do I do? Well, let me tell you, if you write a letter to kind of help him out, the call for help. Now, for Kierkegaard, he assumes that there's a need for infinite help, because of infinite torture and torment and anguish and dread. And he sees nothing but nihilistic possibilities without some kind of guard or preparation or equipment to hold it at arm's length. You see. So that the guarding of a heart is never going to be solely an affair of mortals alone. is going to be tied to the call for help, which is a call of vulnerability. It's a wail, right? It's not a whine. It's a wailing. It's a call for help. And assuming, waiting, trying to build, stand on the promise that there will be some kind of response to that help. But the guarding is still a choice of mortals, but it's for Kierkegaard, it's horizontal in terms of community, friends, family, and it's vertical in terms of this fundamental divine source of help that in the end for Kierkegaard is the only thing that can preserve any sanity in such a wretched world in which we find ourselves. Does that begin to make some sense of it, though? Yes. Yeah, no, I appreciate that question. You remember when I put forward the formulation about love as one yet many? That there are certain common denominators that you see in erotic love and friendship and in agape divine love, or love in relation to God, a God that is never, ever fully comprehended, a God that makes no sense whatsoever, based on rationality, and hence the need to acknowledge the limitations of rationality. Kierkegaard sometimes calls for the crucifixion of understanding and reason, which is not an attempt to be anti-rational, but it's an attempt to be mature in one's acknowledgement of the limitations of rationality, limitations of understanding. So there's a role for reason and understanding, but it has its own constraints. And he draws a very important distinction the way Kant does between borders and limits. I mean, borders, both sides of the borders are continuous with each other. With limits, you got on one side that which is limitless, and on the other side that which is limited. You see? And he's talking about limits here. He's talking about limits. That was part of his critique of Romanticism. He defined Romanticism as the overflowing of all boundaries. But in the end, does that overflowing actually point one toward a certain kind of love that's tied to some of those characteristics that I was talking about? So to answer your question, it applies to all three. It applies to all three, definitely. Yes. Well, Levinas is highly well read. Remember now, Levinas has an animus against ontology. For Levinas, ethics is the first philosophy. That he was socialized, he was trained and educated by a philosophic genius and gangster named Martin Heidegger. Call him a gangster because he's a Nazi. Call him a philosophic genius because he's a genius. Things get complicated, right? And for Levinas, he says, how could this philosophic genius who made ontology a priority end up being such a gangster? Hater of Jews and so forth. Indifferent to Jews. Refusing to apologize to the Holocaust and so forth and so on. And he says, no, ethics will be central. And what is, and for him, he has a notion of infinity, but it's infinite responsibility, which is always at the ethical register, the ethical level. He doesn't want ontology at all. And he doesn't want any kind of claim about it being a need. You see, because he's got a meta-philosophical discourse going. That's why it's impossible to infer from his metaphilosophical reflections about the face of the other what particular acts ought to be done. He said, it can't be done. I'm putting forward a larger framework that we can then move into more concrete ways of wrestling with what is to be done. One of the reasons why we're not reading, one of the reasons why it'd be difficult to read Levinas in this class is that he's much more preoccupied with the metaphilosophical. And you know our attitude toward the metaphilosophical. Highly suspicious. That doesn't mean you don't read Levinas. I think he's a very important thinker. Very important thinker. I think he's a bit overrated, but we'd have to take a whole seminar for me to argue that, though. But he's indispensable. He is indispensable. But he's very different than Kierkegaard in this way. Very, very much so. Yes, question.
What do you make of Kierkegaard's lack of a solution? The whole, my limited understanding of Kierkegaard ends with the notion that there are no real solutions, and one has to try and merely laugh at the fact that we will regret anything we do. And he doesn't even find hope in religion in that sense. This is, to me, more an intellectual masturbation as opposed to a solution rooted in philosophy.
Mm. Now, you see, wonderful question. For Kierkegaard, to look for a root in philosophy is itself a certain kind of intellectual, whatever you said, masturbation or something. I mean, I don't know if Kierkegaard used that language. I would, but just use your language for the moment. You know what I mean? But see, for Kierkegaard, the very notion of thinking that we finite, fallen, fallible human beings can provide a rational solution for something so overwhelmingly complicated, contradictory, itself is not just a form of intellectual hubris and arrogance, but it's too abstract. But he don't want us to just laugh. I mean, what's interesting is just like Socrates never cries, Jesus never laughs. I mean, that's what drove Thomas More in part crazy in the Tower of London, right? He writes the whole dialogue on trivialization. Why is it Socrates never cries and Jesus never laughs? I need to answer that question before they execute me. That's Thomas More and his friend Erasmus. I got to respond to that. There is something comic about Jesus. Exactly. There is something comic about Jesus in terms of incongruity. That's why he spoke in parabolic language. What are parables? Are they logical arguments? What are parables? Are they transparent formulations? What are parables? They deal with the opaque and the vague, precisely what the comic is about, our limitations in our mind. So it's not that Kierkegaard would ever say we just laugh ourselves. No, he said we got to love ourselves through it. We got to love ourselves through it. And to live a life of love is not a rational solution. It's a form of existential engagement, of coping, of wrestling. And he thinks that's the best finite human beings can do in space and time. Is that fair? Based on what you read, definitely. No, I think that laughing is. Now, I happen to believe that, you know, I'm a Chekhovian Christian, so Chekhov for me is central, and he is the great artist of the comic, high comedy. Right. Sad soul, loving disposition. He's a blues man. Catastrophe coming at you. Style, smile, love, compassion, Lucille, guitar, B.B. King. Is that a solution? No, that's a life lived. See what I mean? That's no solution. Mm-mm. The catastrophe still coming at you. Good morning, heartache. There it is again. Tell us about it, Billy. Watch me sing it. Listen to me sing it. Watch the unbelievable resilience and remembrance in my artistic depiction of that, you see. That's very Chekhovian in that way. I think Chekhov's even deeper than the blues, but that's a whole different thing. That's a whole different, because the blues comes out of the United States, and if they come out of the States, it's going to have some real limitations. Because we're a romantic project. We're all about possibility. No limits, no constraints. How juvenile. Yeah, you're going to live forever, uh-huh. Yeah, you're going to be happy forever. Go to Disneyland. not your hood or neighborhood. Very American. Chekhov didn't have that backdrop. So even the blues, as deeply tragic comic as they are, still American, got a romantic stamp on. Tomorrow it'd be better. That's not Chekhov. Tomorrow you better get yourself together. That green light that F. Scott Fitzgerald talked about at the end of Great Gatsby. Believing in the green light, tomorrow's going to be bigger, tomorrow's going to be better. That's American. There's elements of that in the blues. Don't get that in Chekhov at all, whatsoever. The only person that you don't get that in is Melville in some way, and Toni Morrison, who comes right out of Melville tradition in the 20th century. And there's a few others, but Faulkner too, but I mean, there's a few others. But my point is that when you're really talking about solutions, philosophic, rational, you go as far as you can, but then you acknowledge reasons, sweet shipwreck. Boom, hit up against the limits of your mind and intelligence. Now what you gonna do? How you gonna live? How you gonna proceed? We got one last question.
Oh, well, that's well. You all got some questions today. Yeah. But again, you know, you talking about the black church is just such a rich tradition. Just so many different forms and venues and styles and so forth. But certainly, to go back to the sorrow songs that Du Bois talked about in the last chapter, Souls of Black Folk, has everything to do with how are you going to confront the catastrophic in such a way that you don't opt for hatred and revenge as opposed to love and justice? And that's precisely what the best of my own foremothers and forefathers did. They looked the catastrophe in the face and still talked about love and justice the way Douglass and Harriet Tubman and Martin King and the others did. You see, that takes a level of spiritual maturity, moral magnanimity, and courage to do that. Because most of us, in the face of terror, want to end up terrorizing others. In the face of catastrophe, we want to project catastrophe on others. Hate for hate, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, so forth and so on, you see. But that had much to do with their encounter with the same tradition I was talking about. Their encounter with a particular understanding of a Jesus that told them it is better to be defeated at the moment with their spiritual integrity and moral magnanimity than to win and be successful and be like the gangsters. We see this in this new movie, Black Panther movie, where you got those little dialogues going on about hatred and so forth and so on. We were talking about that before. It was mainly an African affair. There's not a lot of Negroes in the movie. So that they're building on. It's made by black folk who are highly talented, love to death, brother. What's his name? Ryan and Robert Joe Cole, who wrote it, co-wrote it. They're wrestling in part, just hatred versus love, justice versus revenge, and so forth and so on. What's missing is the tradition of black people that unleash the love warriors. Where does Harriet Tubman, where does Ida B. Wells, where does Martin Luther King come from? They don't come from out of the sky. They come from a long tradition of wrestling with catastrophe. And the black musical tradition is, in my mind, the greatest tradition of spiritual and moral fortitude that keeps people on the love train in the face of catastrophe. And you see that at its best in all of the Coltrane Love Supreme to Marvin Gaye, Ray Charles, and go on and on, Aretha, that love, that self-giving and unbelievable self-emptying with a master of their technique expressed sonically, expressed in sound, and the courage and the magnanimity in the sound itself that is a building up. Kierkegaard called it an upbuilding. Its aim is to build other people up as they come to terms with their catastrophe, as they come to terms with their deep crises, and so forth and so on. And the last 25, 30 years, we've been losing that. Market's taking over. Money, money, money. Image, image, image. Body stimulation, not a whole lot of existential nurturing and care in the music. And you see that in the lives. Make it difficult for deep paideia to take place. And music used to be a fundamental source of that paideia, especially for
200 some years, was against the law for black people to learn how to read and write. So the music became the fundamental way, a crucial way, of shaping a soul that allowed a love of child and friend and others to go on and not become haters of even the vicious gangsters who were the slaveholders and others complicitous with slavery that were trying to crush them every day. You can even love them. They say, Martin Luther King Jr., how could you love Bull O'Connor? He's a gangster. He taught Sunday school on the vanilla side of town, but he was still a gangster. He said he loved Jesus. Well, Ku Klux Klan is into the cross, too. How'd you do it, Martin? Couldn't do it by myself. Come from a tradition.
Read some Kierkegaard.
And read some Howard Thurman. And listen to some Mahalia Jackson. And you see that love flowing anyway. Doesn't make any sense. Not supposed to make sense. The moment Christianity starts making sense in the eyes of the world, give it up. Not going to make no sense. But I can't get tenure without it. Give up your tenure. That's too much. Okay, you're not a Christian, then go on and do what you got to do. You got different concerns. You got to pick up your cross. You got to give something up. You got to take a risk. You got to be vulnerable. You see what I mean? I mean, I'm not just talking just to you. I'm talking to everybody. I'm zeroing in on you because you raised that question. But we got to save time for our dear brother here.
There's plenty of time.
Absolutely.
So let me begin by locating where we are in the project of
yes,
the course.
Yes, yes.
Our theme here are what we called on the first day of class the first order projects in the conduct of life. Yeah. Rather than meta ethics. And this week and in the next week, we address the first order projects that are directly informed by the Christian vision of life. Mm-hmm. Christianity is the single greatest influence in the evolution of our civilization and in its moral and political ideas. Now, it's very hard to speak about these things. And it's very hard to speak about them for two reasons. One reason is that here we are addressing subjects that are almost unthinkable and almost unsayable, trying to go up to the limit of what can be thought and said about our situation in the world. And we have to persist and try, nevertheless, to think and to speak as forcefully and clearly as possible. The second reason why it's hard to address these topics is that in these contemporary societies, in the liberal democracies of today, and especially in the United States, there is a taboo against the religious criticism of religion. In what I want to say today, I have to violate that taboo. It is unacceptable. It's unacceptable because it belittles both religion and democracy. It is incompatible with a disposition to take religion seriously. Religion is a claim about the truth. The truth as it bears on the conduct of life and the organization of society. Mm-hmm. And when it is faithful to its own nature, it demands to inform the whole of personal and social experience. And the taboo against the religious criticism of religion is also dismissive of democracy. Democracy, if it is for real, is a contest about the structure of society and its alternative futures. And that context has to be informed by our conceptions of humanity and of what humanity can become. And religion historically is the single greatest source of inspiration of those views. So if we are prohibited from speaking in a religious voice in the public space, we can contribute to the deepening of democracy. So this taboo, although it's very generally respected, has to be defied. It has a special force in the United States, this taboo, because in the American civil religion, the idea of the privatization of religion, religion is a matter of private conscience or even private taste, took on great force under the influence of ideas that became prevalent in the middle history of Protestantism, as we discussed in an earlier class. I will proceed in three steps. There's a great deal to say, but our discussion continues next week. The first part of my remarks is about nihilism and dread. Dread of our mortality and our groundlessness. The second set of remarks is about faith and doubt, and in particular, faith in the Semitic salvation religions, and especially in Christianity, our immediate theme today. And then the third set of remarks is about the content of the Christian message regarding the conduct of life. And the difficulty, the special difficulty in this third set of remarks is that strangely, what would be the Orthodox Christian message is not really clearly expressed in the history of Christian doctrine. To a large extent, the history of Christian doctrine is a history of heretical deviations from what seems to me to be the real message. So first, nihilism and dread, a subject central to Kierkegaard. Nihilism is the conviction, the experience, that our existence, our place in the world makes no sense. It has no meaning. Or we can't understand it, we can't represent it in terms that are in communion with our ordinary experience. The world is strange. There's no way in which we can ground ourselves from outside ourselves. All we have is ourselves. And then we seem to be compelled to self-grounding. And this self-grounding is not enough. Now, there is a contemporary philosophical thesis that the idea of nihilism arises from a misunderstanding, that it's somehow incoherent. So according to this view, we can only speak in a particular situation, in a particular tradition, in a particular world, on the basis of its meanings and its values. So on this view, the whole idea of nihilism presupposes that we can stand outside. And they say we can't. Now, I think that this objection is false and arises from a misunderstanding of our situation and a diminishment of our powers. We can stand outside, all of us. At any moment in our lives can stop the normal flow of routines and ask himself, herself, what is the meaning of this? Where am I coming from? Where am I going? What is the larger significance of human existence? We can ask that question. And that is the question that gives rise to the problem of nihilism. That our existence is groundless. This experience of groundlessness gains force by its relation to our mortality. If we were not doomed to die, the experience of groundlessness would lose much or almost all of its force, because we would be in a perpetual present. There would always be further time to investigate, but there isn't time. Our existence has a dramatic concentration, and it is therefore this fact of mortality that gives its force to our groundlessness and generates the problem of nihilism. Now consider what are the answers that have been proposed in the history of thought to this experience of nihilism. The first answer is a practical answer. The response to nihilism, according to this view, is re-engagement in society and connection with other people. There is no other answer. So David Hume describes how when he thinks about the situation of existence, he falls into melancholy, into despair. And then he goes back to the company of his friends, to his tasks, and he overcomes this experience. Pascal has the same idea. It's custom and society that save us from nihilism. But then it's as if this re-engagement of society were simply a forgetting of the problem, a suppression of the problem, a practical solution, but not really a response to our puzzlement and our terror in these moments when we step aside and view our situation from above. Now, the second answer to nihilism, and the answer that occupies the greater part of the history of philosophy and of religion, is to develop a series of narratives. Let me call them feel-good stories that explain why the situation is not as bad as it seems to be. And now, there's a difficulty about these feel-good stories, which is this, that the better the news that they deliver, the harder it is to believe them. So, for example, one category of feel-good stories are the monistic philosophies. There's really only one being, time is illusory, we're all part of the same thing, this same thing is timeless, and so forth. So that response, that narrative, has the problem of devaluing our engagements and connections, of making them seem unreal or less real, and according to Hume and Pascal, is precisely our engagements and connections that are the only practical response to the experience of groundlessness and therefore to the idea of nihilism. Then there's a second category of these narratives. And the second category is, we have a friend in charge of the universe. He longs for us, we long for him. We'll always be together, he and us. And he'll take care of us. Now that's the best possible news that we could have in response to this situation. But it's the news that may be hardest to believe. Now there's a third set of answers to the experience of groundlessness and the problem of nihilism, which is exemplified by classical Confucianism, not the neo-Confucianist metaphysics that came later. Classical Confucianism in its initial move could be seen as an anti-metaphysical metaphysic. It says, in effect, the world is meaningless, the great natural world, the cosmos. we can't translate it into terms that make sense for us. But within this meaningless cosmos, we collectively, in our civilizations, can develop meaning. Meaning for us. We are the creators of meaning through this collective self-grounding. And that's another kind of answer that bears some relation to the first answer I mentioned, but now viewed on a larger stage, historical and collective, rather than just a pragmatic response by the individual. But it doesn't deny the fundamental problem of our being groundless in the world, collectively. It says, in effect, let's make the best of that situation. And it doesn't negate what on the face of things seems to be the case. Namely, that there's no one here but us. And we don't know what it all means. I want to suggest a fourth kind of response to the problem of nihilism and the experience of groundlessness. A response that has an affinity with Kierkegaard, despite Kierkegaard's representation of himself as a Christian, his genuine Christian faith. The fourth answer is that we actually need this experience of dread, of terror, of our groundlessness and our mortality. And that rather than trying to dispose of it, we should reckon with it and make it a part of our existence and of our way of thinking about it ourselves. So first, it is an indispensable antidote to conformity, to our somnambulance. It wakes us up. It's as if we were condemned to be executed and woken up a few moments before our execution. And then we are concentrated on time, on experience, on the present moment. If we are somnambulant, if we are subordinate to these routines, we lose the precious gift of life right now. All we have in the end, all of us, is the present moment. We need to be terrorized to escape conformity. Second, this shadow of our mortality and groundlessness is also necessary as a safeguard against Prometheanism. Prometheanism is the belief that we're like little gods. It's a kind of triumphalism. As I said before, beating the drums in the presence of death, a celebration of power. And through the celebration of power, a negation, as if power could negate death and groundlessness. And it is a denial of our true situation, of our fragility, and of our perplexity. We have the attribute of transcendence, over context. We're not just the puppets of our context, but we don't have the attributes of omniscience and omnipotence. So in this respect, the confrontation with mortality and with groundlessness is like the experience of the victor who stands in his chariot in the Roman triumphal processions, while a slave stands alongside him as he receives the adulation of the crowd and whispers into his ear, "Memento mori," remember that you will die. It is the counterbalance to the Prometheanism. Now, the third reason why we need it is a more fundamental reason even than these two. We need it because it's the truth. And because if we surrender to these feel-good stories, then we are trying to deal with our situation by casting a spell on ourselves. So it's to make ourselves serene, but at the cost of remaining in contact with the reality of our situation. And then this self-deception threatens to contaminate and confuse everything else that we do in the world. So that's then a different idea of how we should deal with the problem of nihilism. We should deal with the problem of nihilism by maintaining our confrontation with nihilism at the cost of this dread, mm-hmm. and making it a part of our experience rather than trying to explain it away or to suppress it. Now then, there's this following problem. Pascal says we can't look at death directly because it's too terrifying. It would blind. It's like a sun that would blind us. But then the opposite is also true. We can't look at life directly because if we think about it, the experience of being alive right now, awoken from this somnambulance, is as if we had, each of us, won the cosmic lottery of having this precious gift of life, even though we have it temporarily. And that too, if we were able to dwell on it, would paralyze us and confuse us just as death does. And so in this situation in which we find ourselves, it's as if we have to run back and forth between these two suns. And in this middle area, then develop our experience. So that's another conception, another view of how we should deal with the problem of nihilism, by reaffirming it, by including it, and by undergoing then this experience of persistent dread as part of the condition of our humanity and of our ascent to a higher form of life. Now I come to my second set of remarks about the world religions. In order immediately afterwards to say something about faith and doubt, Kierkegaard's other great theme. From a little before the middle of the first millennium before Christ to a little after the second half of the first millennium before Christ to a little after the first half of the first millennium after Christ, humanity underwent a momentous spiritual transformation, the rise of what we now describe as the world religions or the higher religions, from the emergence of prophetic Judaism to the prophetic activity of Muhammad. And that included, in the middle period, not alongside Christianity, the emergence of Buddhism, of Confucianism, and of the other philosophical schools of ancient China. This was the most remarkable change in the history of mankind. And it is still today absolutely baffling for reasons that will become clearer, I hope, in the course of these remarks. These religions were very different from one another. Nevertheless, they had certain elements in common. And in particular, they had the following five elements in common. First of all, they all involved a desanctification of the world. In the previous religious experience of humanity, the world itself, nature, was regarded as the sacred. Now the world is desanctified, and for that reason becomes a plausible object of transformation. The divine is located beyond, in some way, even in Confucianism, where the divine is, in a sense, our distinctive human attributes, our moral sensibility, our humanity toward one another. And there then begins a dialectic between transcendence, the transcendence of the divine over the world, over nature, and immanence, the indwelling of the divine in nature. In the Hebrew Bible, God says, I shall pour out my spirit unto all flesh. And in all of these religions, there is that, that the divine is projected beyond nature and then returns to the world in some form to infuse it and to change it. The second characteristic of these world religions is that they all take a position with respect to those seemingly irreparable flaws in the human condition. Our mortality, our groundlessness, our insatiability, to which one could add in a special category our susceptibility to belittlement. In the previous stage of the religious evolution of humanity, the central concern was our dependence on nature, the powers of nature over us. And we worship what had power over us. And now the central object of the religious consciousness becomes these wounds in the human condition that we are unable to repair. And each of these religions takes a position with respect to those wounds, either to deny them because there's some larger narrative, or to provide a series of remedies against them. The third common attribute of these world religions is that they represent all of the divisions within humanity, the divisions of caste and class and everything, gender, as being relatively shallow, as not going all the way down. And this was a revolution in the consciousness of humanity. Now, of course, there's an ambiguity. So the religion says the slave owner and the slave are the same. A Roman Stoic could believe that. But are they the same just as a matter of description, or do they need to be made the same by some kind of transformation? And that ambiguity remains unresolved for the most part in these religions. The fourth common attribute of these world religions is that they introduce a revolutionary ethic, an ethic of universal fellow feeling or solidarity. Contrary to the dominant ethic in the historical civilizations and the great agrarian bureaucratic empires of antiquity, which was especially the ethic associated with the fighters and the rulers, the ethic of proud self-assertion, of revenge, of dominion, of triumph, was essentially, as it were, the ethic of little boys. Don't diss me. This was the predominant moral idea in the history of civilization before the rise of these world religions. Now, this is something absolutely astonishing, because it's not as if the world, these religions said, control this impotence to power, to dominion, in order to be able to cooperate more effectively for your own interests. They said something much more radical, which was entirely in stark contradiction, not only to the dominant moral ideas, but to our ordinary moral experience. They said, turn the other cheek. And so this, what's astonishing is that religions that propose these beliefs in such violent contradiction, not only to the dominant ideas, but to ordinary experience, should have taken over the world and penetrated all of these great civilizations and overthrown their established doctrines. The fifth characteristic of these religions is that they offered humanity a kind of two-sided ticket. It was ambiguous. One side of the ticket was a license to escape from the world, to escape from the present organization of society, to some other form of consciousness or experience, without having to change the world. And the other side of the ticket was then a command to change the world. Mm-hmm. And this is the great ambivalence, the ambiguity in these world religions. Were they a license to escape or a command to transform? Now, within these religions that shared, despite their enormous differences, these five common attributes, come the Semitic salvation religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. They deliver the best possible news, but the news that may be the hardest to believe. And they present a narrative of the transactions between a transcendent God and humanity. God intervenes, God erupts in human history and has a redemptive plan. And we then understand our relation to God and our relations to one another by analogy. We understand our relations to one another in the light of our relation to God. The other is the living God. And we understand our relation to God in the light of our relations to one another. So God longs for us as we long for him. So the whole world of human interaction is then enveloped within a larger narrative that deepens and extends rather than denying our ordinary moral experience. Now, I say all of this just by way of background to dealing with then the problem of faith and doubt that is so central in Kierkegaard and in the moral deployment of Christianity. Within these Semitic salvation religions, Christianity is distinguished from the other two, from Judaism and from Islam, especially in the two following ways. The first is its radical assertion of the idea of the incarnation. So it's not just that there is a general dialectic of transcendence and immanence. God became man so that men could increase their share in the divine life. And this idea of the incarnation was very troubling, always, even within the church. So early in the history of the church, there were a long series of heresies that denied the full force of the doctrine of the incarnation. For example, the Nestorian heresy that asserted that the two natures of God, of Christ, the human and the divine, were separated. Or more radically, Docetism, which asserted that Christ was only an extraordinary individual, not the incarnate God, who then died on the cross. So it was a struggle to develop this full doctrine of the incarnation. The second major way in which Christianity differed from the other two Semitic salvation religions was the central role in it of antinomianism, which is the denial of the primacy of rules or of laws as a guide to the conduct of life and to the organization of society. The predominant theologies in Judaism and Islam became legalistic. The halakha, the sharia. But in Christianity, the orthodoxy was always antinomian. In Judaism and Christianity, there were, of course, antinomian elements in the mystical countercurrents to the orthodoxy. Now then comes the problem of belief. So in these Semitic salvation religions, in all of them, in all three of them, the believer faces scandals of reason and a scandal of faith. There are three scandals of reason. The first scandal of reason is the scandal of supernaturalism. God made the world. Its causal connections are part of his plan. But for him to work his redemptive activity in the world, the normal reign of causality has to be somehow suspended. Now, how can it be suspended? We have the problem of counterfactual reasoning. If it's suspended in some ways, how can everything else go on as if it as before? It seems completely arbitrary. The second scandal of reason is the scandal of particularity. The message is universal, but the plot is particular. Why, for example, did God become incarnate as a Jewish Palestinian peasant in a peripheral province of the Roman Empire during the reign of the Emperor Augustus? Why didn't he become incarnate before, bringing salvation sooner to more people, or incarnate later, when the message might have been subject to less perversion? There's no answer to these problems. It's perplexing that the universal plot should be carried by a particular message. Now comes the third scandal of reason, which is, in a sense, the most radical. The third scandal of reason is the scandal of the incoherence of the idea of God. What I mean by the incoherence of the idea of God is that it seems that none of the three conceptions of God that we can coherently formulate is compatible with the role that the conception of God has to play in each of these three religions. So the first conception of God is that God is a person, by analogy to us. So, but then it's a transparent anthropomorphic projection. How can God be a person and be at the same time the fundamental reality? The second conception of God is that God is being, impersonal, like the God of Aristotle, of the philosophers. Not the living God, the God who becomes incarnate and is crucified. But if God is being, how can God play this redemptive role in his transactions with humanity? The third conception of God is the conception that prevails in the mystical traditions within Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, the via negativa, as it's called in Christian theology. God is non-being and non-person. That is to say, we define God by negation. But then it's simply an abdication of our ability to comprehend God, to represent God. Those are the scandals of reason. And now comes the scandal of faith. So Kierkegaard discusses faith, as many Christian theologians do, as if there were a kind of experience of revelation that carried its truth on its face. That is to say, it overpowered us. So we never had the problem, we would never have the problem of having a criterion of choosing. We would never be able to choose. It would be like a storm that would take us over. And the problem of its truth would never arise. It would announce itself as the truth. But in fact, our ideas matter. And we know, and millions of people know, that we have the experience of struggling with faith and doubting faith. And indeed, Kierkegaard himself says that true faith is accompanied by doubt. Otherwise, it's not for real. And there is an aspect of faith that must be especially troubling. And that is that for the vast majority of people in the world who are believers in one of these religions, it is obviously the case that they believe in their religion because their fathers and mothers did. Now, it's true that there's an experience of conversion, but conversion, too, depends on accidents because we found an inspired teacher who exemplified something, but then preached an exclusive truth. So faith is not a self-identifying, self-legitimating experience. We acquire faith, and then we can lose faith. Even if we want to have faith. So a very characteristic experience now in the rich North Atlantic societies is that while part of the population is agnostic, another part finds itself in a situation of half-belief. And living faith is then, for tens of millions of people, replaced by a sentimental will to believe. We want to believe. But is this acceptable? Is this faith? And what kind of faith? And this kind of half-belief then seems to undermine the power of religion to override the conventional moral and political pieties of the day. It becomes a kind of window dressing, a retrospective representation of what in secular terms we would believe anyway. William James says, people believe everything they can. So then the question becomes, how much can we believe? Wanting to believe and not being able to. And then this casts a troubling light on our experience of faith. Now, I had planned then to advance to the third set of my remarks about the content of the Christian message, but I think I should stop. Because something has been said already about nihilism and dread and faith and doubt, and we might postpone that part of the discussion to next week and now discuss. Will you want to begin, Cornell, by?
You mean where you're right and where you're wrong?
No, I'm being facetious here. But no, I think that the issue of the accidental character of what we end up believing, which families we have, which culture, which religions, which country, and so forth, is very real. That's inescapable, there's no doubt. But what's at the center of Kierkegaard in particular and the Christian Weltanschauung in general is you still have to choose. You still have to choose. There is an inescapable fiduciary dimension in the human condition. It has to do with what is trustworthy and what is not. And that's true whether you have cognitive commitments to God or not. The wonderful book, the last book of the great H. Richard Niebuhr, who's the father of our beloved Richard Niebuhr, taught at Harvard Divinity School for many years. And he talks about faith on earth, and he's talking about the inescapable trust element in any view of the world, be it that of the secular priesthood in the physics department that are preoccupied with production, or in religious department that have to do with stories and narratives and myths and legends and so forth. So if there's an inescapable fiduciary element, and it's also true, as Brother Roberto rightly notes, that there's an accidental character to whatever kinds of choices we make, that still in no way downplays the urgency of having to choose, and choosing in such a way, and this is what I love about Brother Roberto, doing it in such a way that it has an intellectual integrity as well as an existential integrity, which is to say, it's not an abstract choice connected to some academic game or puzzle, but what kind of life are you willing to live and what kind of cost are you willing to pay in the choices that you make?
So, Cornell, this is a variant of a problem we discussed in our very first class, which is the problem of the disproportion between the weight of our commitment and the adequacy of the grounds for it. So we can't escape a position.
I will say that again because it failed.
So this, I was saying, it's a variant of the problem that came up in our very first class here.
Right.
About the which, when I was describing those characteristics of this form of consciousness that is the common ground of religion and philosophy, the last attribute was this attribute of faith.
That's right.
And faith in this sense, that we can't escape a commitment.
Absolutely.
We can't escape committing our lives in one direction or another. We don't have the choice not to do it, because if we don't do it explicitly, we'll do it implicitly.
That's right.
But that's the most important choice we can make. That's the choice of how we use this precious good of life.
Absolutely.
But the grounds for making that choice seem utterly disproportionate to the faithfulness of the choice.
Absolutely.
That the grounds are always incomplete. Now, but that's not the same thing as saying that there are no grounds and that we're not able to argue, to think, to elicit the lessons of our experience or our discoveries about ourselves and about the world. So Kierkegaard sometimes writes as if this was just a blind commitment that we could say nothing about. But first of all, we can say a great deal about it, even though what we can say about it is not enough, and not proportionate to the conclusion. And second, it's not true, this is the other point that came up in the discussion of faith, that the experience of faith is somehow irresistible, and that we don't have to subject it to criticism, to a searching, because it will somehow just take us over. We can fall into faith or we can fall out of faith, and we then have this position of what to do about it. And what is the role that our thinking plays in that experience?
Absolutely. I mean, a wonderful example would be that of Dostoevsky. Now, those who read Brothers Karamazov know that that text has generated more atheists who went into the text religious and came out rejecting the existence of God. That was not Dostoevsky's point. He was a Christian. It just happens to be the case that a Christian writes one of the major indictments of the Christian faith in literary form, meaning that ideas do matter, meaning that no matter how accidental we find ourselves in different families, communities, and traditions, that we can change our minds based on
various kinds of depictions, narratives, arguments, but it's still arbitrary to the degree to which your access to Dostoevsky's text itself is accidental. That is to say, if you view it as accidental all the way down, then it means that you still have to choose. There has to be a quality of your choice. There has to be a depth of commitment, but the evidence will always be underdetermined. Now, just because it's underdetermined doesn't mean there's no evidence at all. I mean, that's what I see you saying in regard to Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard does believe that there's some evidence, but for Kierkegaard, and I think he's right about this, it has to do with one being honest about one's own life and the nature of the existential appropriation of agents yes. rendered in religious narratives. You see. Now, a lot of that has to do with, and this is where Durkheim plays an important role. When Durkheim argues, what's at the center of religious faith? Ancestor appreciation. Now, he's not a reductionist. He's too sophisticated for that.
He's a pagan.
What's that, Durkheim?
Pagan, yes.
Well, no, you can't say Durkheim's a pagan, though, brother.
Ancestors.
No, but I mean, no, but he's come out of a Jewish context yes, in which yes, ancestors but play a role.
Yes, but in this doctrine, pagan.
Because of ancestor appreciation? But it's not ancestor worship, yes. It's ancestor appreciation.
But
I mean, you appreciate Aristotle and Hegel. those are your ancestors. You appreciate them, but that doesn't make you pagan, sure. even though.
But look, something more should be said
by way of the
substantive moral vision, which is a bridge between this discussion and the discussion we should have.
Yeah, now we got to get to your third part. That content.
So central to these religions, and informing the most characteristic. Moral projects in the modern world are these two ideas. So the first idea is the idea of infinity. We're not what we seem to be. We participate in the divine life, and we are capable of increasing our share in the attributes that we ascribe to the divine. We can ascend to a higher form of experience. That's the first idea. And the second idea is that we are radically incomplete. We can't, as individuals, save ourselves. Mm-hmm. We are saved in the intimate domain through love, and then in the external life of society through cooperation and solidarity, which is, as it were, a diffuse an attenuated form of love among strangers. This is the central message. And it's this is not just the message of the Christian version of the moral projects. This is the message, this dialectic of infinity and of love, which in one way or another informs all of the characteristic first order moral projects in the modern world. And so we have to take a position with respect to that message. Mm-hmm. To make sense of it, to ask to what extent it depends on this underlying narrative of redemption or can be made independent of that narrative, and what particular form it should have, how it should be translated into a set of proposals, both for the conduct of life and for the organization of society. So that's the central part of our intellectual program here.
Mm-hmm. No, I'd agree with that, though. Absolutely. We got a hand before we.
I'm curious what you would say about what separates nihilism from being a religion and how we're setting up the faith versus the secular. Because I think one could say that your solution.
Well, because I'm taking as the common character of religious experience those features that I described in the first day of class, that an imperative of existence is anchored in a vision of reality, that this vision of reality crosses the divide between the is and the ought, And that the imperative and the vision elicit faith in the double sense of demanding a commitment for which there are not adequate grounds, and forcing us to become more vulnerable to other people in the course of acting. So nihilism doesn't even get to the first step. Nihilism says, we can't make sense of this situation. It's meaningless for us. So literally, anything is as good as any other thing. We're left with a series of arbitrary choices or commitments. That is the most radical form of nihilism. And that's not a religion, not even in the loose terms of that description of religion.
But nihilism does make the claim about groundlessness.
Yes.
I mean, there you yes. I mean, there's an elective affinity and similarity there. It's just that they draw very different conclusions.
In registering the reality of groundlessness in its connection to mortality.
Mm-hmm. But it remains spectatorial. I think that's also something that Professor Unger, it remains spectatorial, like a cynic. It remains putting one in the position of being the spectator as if you are not always already a participant in space and time on your way to the culinary delight of terrestrial worms. The nihilist has to acknowledge that. You say, nihilist, does that mean anything to you? No, not really. Then why did you get up this morning and not kill yourself? Well, I got a TV show I want to watch. Oh, I see. There's some evaluative activity at work in the enactment of what you're doing, no matter what. Well, what else can I could do? I'm still suspending judgment, so I just conform to the appearances, the way the old classical, the skeptics of classical antiquity. So you just conform to appearances along with suspending judgment. But they're still spectators. Whereas I think what we're talking about and what Kierkegaard is saying is, in the end, even the spectatorial posture is a species of being a participant. You're just either scared, you're cowardly, or you don't want to pay costs. You don't want to be committed. You're committed to being not committed, or whatever, however formulation you want to make it, you see. So in that sense, you're trying to ensure that you don't evade and avoid the choice that must be made. And that's one way of getting at the nihilist when it comes to the common claim about being groundless, but different kinds of conclusions following from groundless, because to be groundless is not to say there's absolutely no ground at all. It's just not enough ground to justify this particular option for why you're alive, what purpose and mission and calling you have in life.
Our time has ended.
Time? Oh, yeah. Okay. So we're gonna carry Kierkegaard over next week, because there's no Hegel without Kierkegaard, no Kierkegaard without Hegel. And who else did we read? Rahner. And the inimitable Karl Barth himself. Absolutely. Well, that was good stuff.
No, we got, I think maybe, I think you should bring that in next week. What do you
think? I with the Grand Inquisitor.